Thanks for watching. If you liked this video, make sure to subscribe for more. The Burrow by Franz Kafka. Page 18. I must have slept for a long time. I was only wakened when I had reached the last light sleep, which dissolves of itself, and it must have been very light, for it was an almost inaudible whistling noise that wakened me. I recognized what it was immediately. The small fry, whom I had allowed far too much latitude, had burrowed a new channel somewhere during my absence. This channel must have chanced to intersect an older one. The air was caught there, and that produced the whistling noise. What an indefatigably busy lot these small fry are, and what a nuisance their diligence can be. First I shall have to listen at the walls of my passages and locate the place of disturbance by experimental excavations, and only then will I be able to get rid of the noise. However, this new channel may be quite welcome as a further means of ventilation, if it can be fitted into the plan of the burrow. But after this I shall keep a much sharper eye on the small fry than I used to. I shall spare none of them. As I have a good deal of experience in investigations of this kind, the work probably will not take me long and I can start upon it at once. There are other jobs awaiting me, it is true, but this is the most urgent. I must have silence in my passages. This noise, however, is a comparatively innocent one. I did not hear it at all when I first arrived, although it must certainly have been there. I must first feel quite at home before I could hear it. It is, so to speak, audible only to the ear of the householder. And it is not even constant, as such noises usually are. There are long pauses, obviously caused by stoppages of the current of air. I start on my investigations, but I can't find the right place to begin at, and though I cut a few trenches, I do it at random. Naturally, that has no effect, and the hard work of digging and the still harder work of filling the trenches up again and beating the earth firm is so much labor lost. I don't seem to be getting any nearer to the place where the noise is. It goes on always on the same thin note, with regular pauses, now a sort of whistling, but again like a kind of piping. Now I could leave it to itself for the time being. It is very disturbing, certainly, but there can hardly be any doubt that its origin is what I took it to be at first, so it can scarcely become louder. Page 19. On the contrary, such noises may quite well, though until now I have never had to wait so long for that to happen, may quite well vanish of themselves in the course of time through the continued labors of these little burrowers, and apart from that, often chance itself puts one on the track of the disturbance, where systematic investigation has failed for a long time. In such ways I comfort myself, and resolve simply to continue my tour of the passages, and visit the rooms, many of which I have not even seen yet since my return, and enjoy myself contemplating the castle keep now and then between times, but my anxiety will not let me, and I must go on with my search. These little creatures take up much, far too much, time that could be better employed. In such cases as the present, it is usually the technical problem that attracts me. For example, from the noise, which my ear can distinguish in all its finest shades, so that it has a perfectly clear outline to me, I deduce its cause, and now I am on fire to discover whether my conclusion is valid. And with good reason, for as long as that is not established I cannot feel safe, even if it were merely a matter of discovering where a grain of sand that had fallen from one of the walls had rolled to. And a noise such as this is by no means a trifling matter, regarded from that angle. But whether trifling or important, I can find nothing, no matter how hard I search, or it may be that I find too much. This had to happen just in my favorite room, I think to myself, and I walk a fair distance away from it, almost halfway along the passage leading to the next room. I do this more as a joke, pretending to myself that my favorite room is not alone to blame, but that there are disturbances elsewhere as well. And with a smile on my face I begin to listen, but soon I stop smiling, for, right enough, the same whistling meets me here too. It is really nothing to worry about. Sometimes I think that nobody but myself would hear it. It is true, I hear it now more and more distinctly, for my ear has grown keener through practice, though in reality it is exactly the same noise wherever I may hear it, as I have convinced myself by comparing my impressions. Nor is it growing louder. I recognize this when I listen in the middle of the passage instead of pressing my ear against the wall. Then it is only with an effort, indeed with great intentness, that I can more guess at than hear the merest trace of a noise now and then. But it is this very uniformity of the noise everywhere that disturbs me most, for it cannot be made to agree with my original assumption. Page 20. Had I rightly divined the cause of the noise, then it must have issued with greatest force from some given place, which it would be my task to discover, and after that have grown fainter and fainter. But if my hypothesis does not meet the case, what can the explanation be? There still remains the possibility that there are two noises, that up to now I have been listening at a good distance from the two centers, and that while its noise increases, when I draw near to one of them, the total result remains approximately the same for the ear in consequence of the lessening volume of sound from the other center. Already I have almost fancied sometimes, when I have listened carefully, that I could distinguish, if very indistinctly, differences of tone which support this new assumption. In any case, I must extend my sphere of investigation much farther than I have done. Accordingly, I descend the passage to the castle keep and begin to listen there. Strange, the same noise there too. Now it is a noise produced by the burrowing of some species of small fry who have infamously exploited my absence. In any case, they have no intention of doing me harm, they are simply busied with their own work, and so long as no obstacle comes in their way, they will keep on in the direction they have taken. I know all this. Yet that they should have dared to approach the very castle keep itself is incomprehensible to me and fills me with agitation, and confuses the faculties which I need so urgently for the work before me. Here I have no wish to discover whether it is the unusual depth at which the castle keep lies, or its great extent and correspondingly powerful air suction, calculated to scare burrowing creatures away, or the mere fact that it is the castle keep, that by some channel or other has penetrated to their dull minds. In any case, I have never noticed any sign of burrowing in the walls of the castle keep until now. Crowds of little beasts have come here, it is true, attracted by the powerful smells. Here I have had a constant hunting ground, but my quarry has always burrowed away through in the upper passages, and come running down here, somewhat fearfully, but unable to withstand such a temptation. But now, it seems, they are burrowing in all the passages. If I had only carried out the best of the grand plans I thought out in my youth and early manhood, or rather, if I had only had the strength to carry them out, for there would have been no lack of will. Page 21. One of these favorite plans of mine was to isolate the castle keep from its surroundings, that is to say, to restrict the thickness of its walls to about my own height, and leave a free space of about the same width all around the castle keep, except for a narrow foundation, which unfortunately would have to be left to bear up the whole. I had always pictured this free space, and not without reason, as the loveliest imaginable haunt. What a joy to lie pressed against the rounded outer wall, pull oneself up, let oneself slide down again, miss one's footing and find oneself on firm earth, and play all those games literally upon the castle keep and not inside it, to avoid the castle keep, to rest one's eyes from it whenever one wanted, to postpone the joy of seeing it until later and yet not have to do without it, but literally hold it safe between one's claws, a thing that is impossible if you have only an ordinary open entrance to it, but above all to be able to stand guard over it, and in that way to be so completely compensated for renouncing the actual sight of it that, if one had to choose between staying all one's life in the castle keep or in the free space outside it, one would choose the latter, content to wander up and down there all one's days and keep guard over the castle keep. Then there would be no noises in the walls, no insolent burrowing up to the very keep itself, then peace would be assured there and I would be its guardian. Then I would not have to listen with loathing to the burrowing of the small fry, but with delight to something that I cannot hear now at all, the murmurous silence of the castle keep. But that beautiful dream is past and I must set to work, Almost glad that now my work has a direct connection with the castle keep, for that wings it. Certainly, as I can see more and more clearly, I need all my energies for this task, which at first seemed quite a trifling one. I listen now at the walls of the castle keep, and wherever I listen, high or low, at the roof or the floor, at the entrance or in the corners, everywhere, everywhere, I hear the same noise. And how much time, how much care must be wasted in listening to that noise, with its regular pauses? One can, if one wishes, find a tiny deceitful comfort in the fact that here in the castle keep, because of its vastness, one hears nothing at all. Page 22. As distinguished from the passages, when one stands back from the walls. Simply as a rest and a means to regain my composure, I often make this experiment, listen intently and am overjoyed when I hear nothing. But the question still remains, what can have happened? Confronted with this phenomenon, my original explanation completely falls to the ground. But I must also reject other explanations which present themselves to me. One could assume, for instance, that the noise I hear is simply that of the small fry themselves at their work. But all my experience contradicts this. I cannot suddenly begin to hear now a thing that I have never heard before, though it was always there. My sensitiveness to disturbances in the burrow has perhaps become greater with the years, yet my hearing has by no means grown keener. It is of the very nature of small fry not to be heard. Would I have tolerated them otherwise? Even at the risk of starvation, I would have exterminated them. But perhaps, this idea now insinuates itself, I am concerned here with some animal unknown to me. That is possible. True, I have observed the life down here long and carefully enough, but the world is full of diversity and is never wanting in painful surprises. Yet it cannot be a single animal, it must be a whole swarm that has suddenly fallen upon my domain, a huge swarm of little creatures, which, as they are audible, must certainly be bigger than the small fry, but yet cannot be very much bigger, for the sound of their labors is itself very faint. It may be, then, a swarm of unknown creatures on their wanderings, who happen to be passing by my way, who disturb me, but will presently cease to do so. So I could really wait for them to pass, and need not put myself to the trouble of work that will be needless in the end. Yet if these creatures are strangers, why is it that I never see any of them? I have already dug a host of trenches, hoping to catch one of them, but I can find not a single one. Then it occurs to me that they may be quite tiny creatures, far tinier than any I am acquainted with, and that it is only the noise they make that is greater. Accordingly, I investigate the soil I have dug up, I cast the lumps into the air so that they break into quite small particles, but the noisemakers are not among them. Slowly I come to realize that by digging such small fortuitous trenches I achieve nothing, in doing that I merely disfigure the walls of my burrow, scratching hastily here and there without taking time to fill up the holes again. At many places already there are heaps of earth which block my way and my view. Page 23. Still, that is only a secondary worry, for now I can neither wander about my house, nor review it, nor rest. Often already I have fallen asleep at my work in some hole or other, with one paw clutching the soil above me, from which in a semi-stupor I have been trying to tear a lump. I intend now to alter my methods. I shall dig a wide and carefully constructed trench in the direction of the noise and not cease from digging until, independent of all theories, I find the real cause of the noise. Then I shall eradicate it, if that is within my power, and if it is not, at least I shall know the truth. That truth will bring me either peace or despair, but whether the one or the other, it will be beyond doubt or question. This decision strengthens me. All that I have done till now seems to me far too hasty. In the excitement of my return, while I had not yet shaken myself free from the cares of the upper world, and was not yet completely penetrated by the peace of the burrow, but rather hypersensitive at having had to renounce it for such a long time, I was thrown into complete confusion of mind by an unfamiliar noise. And what was it? A faint whistling, audible only at long intervals, a mere nothing to which I don't say that one could actually get used, for no one could get used to it, but which one could, without actually doing anything about it at once, observe for a while, that is, listen every few hours, let us say, and patiently register the results, instead of, as I had done, keeping one's ear fixed to the wall and at every hint of noise staring out a lump of earth, not really hoping to find anything, but simply so as to do something to give expression to one's inward agitation. All that will be changed now, I hope. And then, with furious shut eyes, I have to admit to myself that I hope nothing of the kind, for I am still trembling with agitation just as I was hours ago, and if my reason did not restrain me I would probably like nothing better than to start stubbornly and defiantly digging, simply for the sake of digging, at some place or other, whether I heard anything there or not, almost like the small fry, who burrow either without any object at all or simply because they eat the soil. My new and reasonable plan both tempts me and leaves me cold. There is nothing in it to object to, I at least know of no objection, it is bound, so far as I can see, to achieve my aim. And yet at bottom I do not believe in it, I believe in it so little that I do not even fear the terrors which its success may well bring, I do not believe even in a dreadful denouement. Page 24. Indeed it seems to me that I have been thinking ever since the first appearance of the noise of such a methodical trench, and have not begun upon it until now simply because I put no trust in it. In spite of that I shall of course start on the trench, I have no other alternative, but I shall not start at once, I shall postpone the task for a little while. If reason is to be reinstated on the throne, it must be completely reinstated, I shall not rush blindly into my task. In any case I shall first repair the damage that I have done to the burrow with my wild digging. That will take a good long time, but it is necessary. If the new trench is really to reach its goal it will probably be long, and if it should lead to nothing at all it will be endless. In any case this task means a longish absence from the burrow, though an absence by no means so painful as an absence in the upper world, for I can interrupt my work whenever I like and pay a visit to my house. And even if I should not do that the air of Castle Keep will be wafted to me and surround me while I work, nevertheless it means leaving the burrow and surrendering myself to an uncertain fate, and consequently I want to leave the burrow in good order behind me, it shall not be said that I, who am fighting for its peace, have myself destroyed that peace without reinstating it at once. So I begin by shoveling the soil back into the holes from which it was taken. A kind of work I am familiar with, that I have done countless times almost without regarding it as work, and at which, particularly as regards the final pressing and smoothing down, and this is no empty boast, but the simple truth, I am unbeatable. But this time everything seems difficult, I am too distracted, every now and then, in the middle of my work, I press my ear to the wall and listen. And without taking any notice let the soil that I have just lifted trickle back into the passage again. The final embellishments, which demand a stricter attention, I can hardly achieve at all. Hideous protuberances, disturbing cracks remain, not to speak of the fact that the old buoyancy simply cannot be restored again to a wall patched up in such a way. I try to comfort myself with the reflection that my present work is only temporary. When I return after peace has been restored I shall repair everything properly, work will be mere play to me then. Oh yes, work is mere play in fairy tales, and this comfort of mine belongs to the realm of fairy tales too. Page 25. It would be far better to do the work thoroughly now, at once, far more reasonable than perpetually to interrupt it and wander off through the passages to discover new sources of noise, which is easy enough. All that is needed being to stop at any point one likes and listen. And that is not the end of my useless discoveries. Sometimes I fancy that the noise has stopped, for it makes long pauses, sometimes such a faint whistling escapes one, one's own blood is pounding all too loudly in one's ears, then two pauses come one after another, and for a while one thinks that the whistling has stopped forever. I listen no longer, I jump up. All life is transfigured, it is as if the fountains from which flows the silence of the burrow were unsealed. I refrain from verifying my discovery at once. I want first to find someone to whom in all good faith I can confide it, so I rush to the castle keep. I remember, for I and everything in me has awakened to new life, that I have eaten nothing for a long time. I snatch something or other from among my store of food half buried under the debris and hurriedly begin to swallow it while I hurry back to the place where I made my incredible discovery. I only want to assure myself about it incidentally, perfunctorily, while I am eating. I listen, but the most perfunctory listening shows at once that I was shamefully deceived. Away there in the distance the whistling still remains unshaken. And I spit out my food, and would like to trample it underfoot, and go back to my task, not caring which I take up, any place where it seems to be needed, and there are enough places like that. I mechanically start on something or other, just as if the overseer had appeared and I must make a pretense of working for his benefit. But hardly have I begun to work in this fashion when it may happen that I make a new discovery. The noise seems to have become louder, not much louder, of course. Here it is always a matter of the subtlest shades, but all the same sufficiently louder for the ear to recognize it clearly. And this growing louder is like a coming nearer, still more distinctly than you hear the increasing loudness of the noise. You can literally see the step that brings it closer to you. You leap back from the wall, you try to grasp at once all the possible consequences that this discovery will bring with it. You feel as if you had never really organized the burrow for defense against attack. You had intended to do so, but despite all your experience of life, the danger of an attack, and consequently the need to organize the place for defense, seemed remote, or rather not remote. How could it possibly be, but infinitely less important than the need to put it in a state where one could live peacefully? And so that consideration was given priority in everything relating to the burrow. Many things in this direction might have been done without affecting the plan of the whole. Most incomprehensibly they have been neglected. I have had a great deal of luck all those years. Luck has spoiled me. I have had anxieties, but anxiety leads to nothing when you have luck to back you. Page 26. The thing to do, really to do now, would be to go carefully over the burrow and consider every possible means of defending it, work out a plan of defense and a corresponding plan of construction, and then start on the work at once with the vigor of youth. That is the work that would really be needed, for which, I may add, it is now far too late in the day, yet that is what would really be needed, and not the digging of a grand experimental trench, whose only real result would be to deliver me hand and foot to the search for danger, out of the foolish fear that it will not arrive quickly enough of itself. Suddenly I cannot comprehend my former plan. I can find no slightest trace of reason in what had seemed so reasonable. Once more I lay aside my work and even my listening. I have no wish to discover any further signs that the noise is growing louder. I have had enough of discoveries. I let everything slide. I would be quite content if I could only still the conflict going on within me. Once more I let my passages lead me where they will. I come to more and more remote ones that I have not yet seen since my return, and that are quite unsullied by my scratching paws, and whose silence rises up to meet me and sinks into me. I do not surrender to it. I hurry on. I do not know what I want, probably simply to put off the hour. I stray so far that I find myself at the labyrinth. The idea of listening beneath the moss covering tempts me. Such distant things, distant for the moment, chain my interest. I push my way up and listen. Deep stillness. How lovely it is here. Outside there nobody troubles about my burrow. Everybody has his own affairs, which have no connection with me. How have I managed to achieve this? Here under the moss covering is perhaps the only place in my burrow now where I can listen for hours and hear nothing. A complete reversal of things in the burrow. What was once the place of danger has become a place of tranquility, while the castle keep has been plunged into the melee of the world and all its perils. Still worse, even here there is no peace in reality. Here nothing has changed. Silent or vociferous, danger lies in ambush as before above the moss. But I have grown insensitive to it. My mind is far too much taken up with the whistling in my walls. Is my mind really taken up with it? It grows louder, It comes nearer, but I wriggle my way through the labyrinth and make a couch for myself up here under the moss. It is almost as if I were already leaving the house to the Whistler, content if I can only have a little peace up here. To the Whistler. Page 27. Have I come, then, to a new conclusion concerning the cause of the noise? But surely the noise is caused by the channels bored by the small fry? Is not that my considered opinion? It seems to me that I have not retreated from it thus far. And if the noise is not caused directly by these channels, it is indirectly. And even if it should have no connection with them whatever, one is not at liberty to make a priori assumptions, but must wait until one finds the cause, or it reveals itself. One could play with hypotheses, of course, even at this stage. For instance, it is possible that there has been a water burst at some distance away, and what seems a piping or whistling to me is in reality a gurgling. But apart from the fact that I have no experience in that sphere, the groundwater that I found at the start I drained away at once, and in this sandy soil it has never returned. Apart from this fact, the noise is undeniably a whistling and simply not to be translated into a gurgling. But what avail all exhortations to be calm? My imagination will not rest, and I have actually come to believe, it is useless to deny it to myself, that the whistling is made by some beast, and moreover not by a great many small ones, but by a single big one. Many signs contradict this. The noise can be heard everywhere and always at the same strength, and moreover uniformly, both by day and night. At first, therefore, one cannot but incline to the hypothesis of a great number of little animals, but as I must have found some of them during my digging and I have found nothing, it only remains for me to assume the existence of a great beast, especially as the things that seem to contradict the hypothesis are merely things which make the beast, not so much impossible, as merely dangerous beyond all one's powers of conception. For that reason alone have I resisted this hypothesis. I shall cease from this self-deception. For a long time already I have played with the idea that the beast can be heard at such a great distance because it works so furiously, it burrows as fast through the ground as another can walk on the open road, the ground still trembles at its burrowing when it has ceased. This reverberation and the noise of the boring itself unite into one sound at such a great distance, and I, as I hear only the last dying ebb of that sound, hear it always at the same uniform strength. Page 28. It follows from this also that the beast is not making for me, seeing that the noise never changes. More likely it has a plan in view whose purpose I cannot decipher. I merely assume that the beast, and I make no claim whatever that it knows of my existence, is encircling me. It has probably made several circles around my burrow already since I began to observe it. The nature of the noise, the piping or whistling, gives me much food for thought. When I scratch and scrape in the soil in my own fashion, the sound is quite different. I can explain the whistling only in this way, that the beast's chief means of burrowing is not its claws, which it probably employs merely as a secondary resource, but its snout or its muzzle, which, of course, apart from its enormous strength, must also be fairly sharp at the point. It probably bores its snout into the earth with one mighty push and tears out a great lump. While it is doing that I hear nothing, that is the pause, but then it draws in the air for a new push. This end roll of its breath, which must be an earth-shaking noise, not only because of the beast's strength, but of its haste, its furious lust for work as well, this noise I hear then as a faint whistling. But quite incomprehensible remains the beast's capacity to work without stopping. Perhaps the short pauses provide also the opportunity of snatching a moment's rest, but apparently the beast has never yet allowed itself a really long rest. Day and night it goes on burrowing, always with the same freshness and vigor, always thinking of its object, which must be achieved with the utmost expedition, and which it has the ability to achieve with ease. Now I could not have foreseen such an opponent. But apart altogether from the beast's peculiar characteristics, what is happening now is only something which I should really have feared all the time, something against which I should have been constantly prepared, the fact that someone would come. By what chance can everything have flowed on so quietly and happily for such a long time? Who can have diverted my enemies from their path, and forced them to make a wide detour around my property? Why have I been spared for so long, only to be delivered to such terrors now? Compared with this, what are all the petty dangers in brooding over which I have spent my life? Had I hoped, as owner of the borough, to be in a stronger position than any enemy who might chance to appear? But simply by virtue of being owner of this great vulnerable edifice, I am obviously defenseless against any serious attack. Page 29. The joy of possessing it has spoiled me, the vulnerability of the borough has made me vulnerable, any wound to it hurts me as if I myself were hit. It is precisely this that I should have foreseen, instead of thinking only of my own defense, and how perfunctorily and vainly I have done even that, I should have thought of the defense of the borough. Above all, provision should have been made for cutting off sections of the borough, and as many as possible of them, from the endangered sections when they are attacked. This should have been done by means of improvised landslides, calculated to operate at a moment's notice. Moreover, these should have been so thick, and have provided such an effectual barrier, that the attacker would not even guess that the real borough only began at the other side. More, these landslides should have been so devised that they not only concealed the borough, but also entombed the attacker. Not the slightest attempt have I made to carry out such a plan, nothing at all has been done in this direction. I have been as thoughtless as a child, I have passed my manhood's years in childish games, I have done nothing but play even with the thought of danger, I have shirked really taking thought for actual danger. And there has been no lack of warning. Nothing, of course, approaching the present situation has happened before, nevertheless there was an incident not unlike it when the borough was only beginning. The main difference between that time and this is simply that the borough was only beginning then. In those days I was literally nothing more than a humble apprentice, the labyrinth was only sketched out in rough outline, I had already dug a little room, but the proportions and the execution of the walls were sadly bungled, in short, everything was so tentative that it could only be regarded as an experiment, as something which, if one lost patience someday, one could leave behind without much regret. Then one day as I lay on a heap of earth resting from my labors, I have rested far too often from my labors all my life, suddenly I heard a noise in the distance. Being young at the time, I was less frightened than curious. I left my work to look after itself and set myself to listen. I listened and listened, and had no wish to fly up to my moss covering and stretch myself out there so that I might not have to hear. Page 30. I did listen, at least. I could clearly recognize that the noise came from some kind of burrowing similar to my own, it was somewhat fainter, of course, but how much of that might be put down to the distance one could not tell. I was intensely interested, but otherwise calm and cool. Perhaps I am in somebody else's borough, I thought to myself, and now the owner is boring his way toward me. If that assumption had proved to be correct, I would have gone away, for I have never had any desire for conquest or bloodshed, and begun building somewhere else. But after all, I was still young and still without a borough, so I could remain quite cool. Besides, the further course of the noise brought no real cause for apprehension, except that it was not easy to explain. If whoever was boring there was really making for me, because he had heard me boring, then if he changed his direction, as now actually happened, it could not be told whether he did this because my pause for rest had deprived him of any definite point to make toward, or because, which was more plausible, he had himself changed his plans. But perhaps I had been deceived altogether, and he had never been actually making in my direction. At any rate, the noise grew louder for a while as if he were drawing nearer, and being young at that time I probably would not have been displeased to see the burrower suddenly rising from the ground, but nothing of that kind happened. At a certain point the sound of boring began to weaken, it grew fainter and fainter, as if the burrower were gradually diverging from his first route, and suddenly it broke off altogether, as if he had decided now to take the diametrically opposite direction and were making straight away from me into the distance. For a long time I still went on listening for him in the silence, before I returned once more to my work. Now that warning was definite enough, but I soon forgot it, and it scarcely influenced my building plans. Page 31. Between that day and this lie my years of maturity, but is it not as if there were no interval at all between them? I still take long rests from my labors and lesson at the wall, and the burrower has changed his intention anew. He has turned back, he is returning from his journey, thinking he has given me ample time in the interval to prepare for his reception. But on my side everything is worse prepared for than it was then. The great burrow stands defenseless, and I am no longer a young apprentice, but an old architect, and the powers I still have fail me when the decisive hour comes. Yet old as I am, it seems to me that I would gladly be still older, so old that I should never be able to rise again from my resting place under the moss. For to be honest, I cannot endure the place. I rise up and rush, as if I had filled myself up there with new anxieties instead of peace, down into the house again. What was the state of things the last time I was here? Had the whistling grown fainter? No, it had grown louder. I listen at 10 places chosen at random and clearly notice the deception. The whistling is just the same as ever, nothing has altered. Over there, there are no changes, there one is come and not worried about time, but here every instant frets and gnaws at the listener. I go once more the long road to the castle keep. All my surroundings seem filled with agitation, seem to be looking at me, and then look away again so as not to disturb me, yet cannot refrain the very next moment from trying to read the saving solution from my expression. I shake my head, I have not yet found any solution. Nor do I go to the castle keep in pursuance of any plan. I pass the spot where I had intended to begin the experimental trench, I look it over once more. It would have been an admirable place to begin at. The trench's course would have been in the direction where lay the majority of the tiny ventilation holes, which would have greatly lightened my labors. Perhaps I should not have had to dig very far, should not even have had to dig to the source of the noise. Perhaps if I had listened at the ventilation holes it would have been enough. But no consideration is potent enough to animate me to this labor of digging. This trench will bring me certainty, you say? I have reached the stage where I no longer wish to have certainty. In the castle keep I choose a lovely piece of flayed red flesh and creep with it into one of the heaps of earth. There I shall have silence, at least, such silence, at any rate, as still can be said to exist here. Page 32. I munch and nibble at the flesh, think of the strange beast going its own road in the distance, and then again that I should enjoy my store of food as fully as possible. While I still have the chance. This last is probably the sole plan I have left that I can carry out. For the rest I try to unriddle the beast's plans. Is it on its wanderings, or is it working on its own burrow? If it is on its wanderings, then perhaps an understanding with it might be possible. If it should really break through to the burrow, I shall give it some of my stores and it will go on its way again. It will go its way again, a fine story. Lying in my heap of earth I can naturally dream of all sorts of things, even of an understanding with the beast, though I know well enough that no such thing can happen, and that at the instant when we see each other, more, at the moment when we merely guess at each other's presence, we shall both blindly bare our claws and teeth, neither of us a second before or after the other, both of us filled with a new and different hunger, even if we should already be gorged to bursting. And with entire justice, for who, even if he were merely on his wanderings, would not change his itinerary and his plans for the future on catching sight of the burrow? But perhaps the beast is digging in its own burrow, in which case I cannot even dream of an understanding. Even if it should be such a peculiar beast that its burrow could tolerate a neighbor, my burrow could not tolerate a neighbor, at least not a clearly audible one. Now actually the beast seems to be a great distance away. If it would only withdraw a little farther the noise too would probably disappear. Perhaps in that case everything would be peaceful again as in the old days. All this would then become a painful but salutary lesson, spurring me on to make the most diverse improvements on the burrow. If I have peace, and danger does not immediately threaten me, I am still quite fit for all sorts of hard work, perhaps. Considering the enormous possibilities which its powers of work opened before it, the beast has given up the idea of extending its burrow in my direction, and is compensating itself for that in some other one. That consummation also cannot, of course, be brought about by negotiation, but only by the beast itself, or by some compulsion exercised from my side. In both cases the decisive factor will be whether the beast knows about me, and if so what it knows. Page 33. The more I reflect upon it, the more improbable does it seem to me that the beast has even heard me. It is possible, though I can't imagine it, that it can have received news of me in some other way, but it has certainly never heard me. So long as I still knew nothing about it, it simply cannot have heard me, for at that time I kept very quiet. Nothing could be more quiet than my return to the burrow. Afterwards, when I dug the experimental trenches, perhaps it could have heard me, though my style of digging makes very little noise, but if it had heard me I must have noticed some sign of it. The beast must at least have stopped its work every now and then to listen. But all remained unchanged. Thanks for watching. If you liked this video, make sure to subscribe for more.